Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. January is generally the coldest month of the year in the northern hemisphere. And we are at the end of the coldest month here. Personally, I enjoy the winter snow a lot. Simply watching the snow has a very calming effect on my mind. If you live in an area which gets a lot of snow, I hope you enjoy it too. First thing first, I would like to tell you that we are working on determining a good solution for publishing the Dao Yi online magazine. If any of you in the community have online publishing experience, we would like to hear your suggestions. We have to strike a balance between functionality and visual appeal to provide a good reading experience to our community members. So, let us know either in the comments or on the feedback channel on the Dao Yi Discord or email me if you prefer to remain anonymous. Many, if not most of you may have come across many hard to understand terms while learning ancient Chinese practice. Very often, the lack of understanding of these terms causes a lot of unnecessary confusion and misperceptions. Even worse, martial art practice often borrow ancient terms to describe martial practice, causing even more confusion. As a result, a lot of simple concepts end up complicated. You may also have noticed that I have been working on the demystification and clarification of such terms in order to provide you with the full context of each term. As a practitioner born and raised in China, I worked hard to provide a clear picture of the traditional arts by maintaining their essence and getting rid of the unnecessary mystified elements added to them. You might be aware of a popular Chinese term, Da Dao Zhi Jian, or the most profound takes the simplest form. The English equivalent could be called elegant simplicity. I follow Da Dao Zhi Jian in presenting information to the community. I hope that outside of China, the community focuses on demystification of concepts and their elegant simplicities instead of doubling down on the rampant misperceptions. Or else, the general understanding and the level of practice in the community will never advance beyond primitive. Today, I'd like to introduce Jiu Gong, an interesting term used not only in martial art practice, but more popularly also in feng shui, Chinese astrology, and other cultural practices. For instance, consider the old kung fu movie Wu Lin Zhi or Deadly Fury, a very popular movie released in 1983. The story was partially based on Han Muxia, a very famous Xingyin master in Tianjin, a disciple of Zhang Zhaodong. In that movie, an old master taught Bagua to the main character, Dong Fang Xu. The practice used in that movie was called Zhuan Jiu Gong, or Nine Palace Walking. Let's watch that movie clip first, so that you get the basic idea.
方喜武功的内在精华，向他展示八卦掌的内在演练。老人家虽然年过半百，但生发敏捷，这就是练武的好处。道理其实就跟现代人的体育锻炼类似，如果长时间练习，就会达到锻炼身体的目的。
What you just watched is called 九宫 practice in 八卦. You may also have encountered the term 九宫 in other fields. 九宫 is often a very confusing term in some fields, especially in Taoist documents, 修道 practice, feng shui, and xing xiang or Chinese astrology. That's why I'd like to explain 九宫 in today's video. Topics covered in today's video include, first, origin and history of 九宫. Second, 九宫 in different practices. Third, 九宫 in martial arts. Fourth, how to practice martial 九宫. Fifth, misperceptions of martial 九宫. Sixth, demonstration. And seventh, takeaways. So, without any further ado, let's get started. First, origin and history of 九宫. 九宫 consists of two characters. 九 means nine and 宫 means palace. Put together, 九宫 means nine palace. Throughout Chinese history and even in modern times, astronomers have used 九宫 to describe the locations of stars. Ancient Chinese astronomers divided the sky into nine areas and named them using 八卦 or eight trigram plus one middle palace. Also, they used 九宫 to analyze the Big Dipper's movements in order to identify directions and seasonal changes in the universe and their impact on life. A legendary story which has been told for thousands of years mentions that an ancient sage observed two sets of patterns on a dragon horse back and a turtle's back, which indicates the secret of the universe. So, people called them 河图 and 路书, or river map and water chart. This is the 河图 and this is the 路书. People used 河图 or river map to set up the positions for each of the five elements and used 路书 to set up 九宫. Actually, nobody knows for certain about the origins of the 河图 and 路书 because people have been able to trace them back to even prehistoric times. I have collected a lot of documents on this topic, but unfortunately, they don't provide a unanimous conclusion. So, all things considered, I believe 河图 and 路书 originated about 2,000 years ago. Since 路书 is directly related to 九宫, the main topic for today, let's first focus on 路书. So, let's take another quick look at 路书. Now, let's first take a close look at 九宫. This is the 九宫 chart, directly converted from 路书. So, what is the relationship among those numbers? The pattern of these numbers is very interesting. Let me give you some examples. If you add the numbers along each vertical, horizontal, and diagonal lines, the result is constantly 15. For example, when you add 4, 3, 8 together, it is 15. The 9, 5, 1 together is 15. 2, 7, 6, 4, 9, 2, 3, 5, 7, 8, 1, 6, 2, 5, 8, 4, 5, 6, and all get 15. Second, the sum of all the numbers on the edge times the center number 5 is 100. And the sum of even numbers on the edge times the center number 5 is 100. 5 in Chinese astrology means 5 elements, and 100 in Chinese means perfect. Third, since 1, 3, 7, 9 are considered young numbers. 3 is the multiplier of young numbers according to Tao Te Ching, as well as Chinese philosophy and culture. So, 1 times 3 is 3. 3 times 3 is 9. 9 times 3 is 27. And the least significant digit of this palace is 7. 7 times 3 is 21. The least significant digit of the palace is 1. So, the clockwise movement is the Yang energy movements. First, since 2, 4, 6, 8 are considered Yin numbers, in old time, 2 is the multiplier of a Yin number according to Yin Yang theory. So, 2 times 2 is 4, 4 times 2 is 8, and 8 times 2 is 16. And the least significant digit is 6. Then 6 times 2 is 12. The least significant digit of 12 is 2. So the counterclockwise movement is the Yin energy movement. There are more interesting relationships among these numbers, but I hope this gives you a general idea. It is worth noting that Jiu Gong has been integrated with Ba Gua or 8 trigrams and used in different applications, which will be introduced in the later sections. So, Jiu Gong is a 9-area pattern indicating different types of inner relationships between each area. For thousands of years, Chinese people have applied this pattern in different practices. Let's move on to the next topic where I will introduce some important applications of Jiu Gong. Topic 2. Jiu Gong in different practices. The concept of Jiu Gong indicates the inner relationship between the 9 area or palaces, which stand for different energy, property, nature, and the function of things. Jiu Gong has been used in many fields throughout Chinese history, including TCM, Feng Shui, Bingfa or military strategy, forecasting, Xiu Dao, Qi Men Dun Jia, and many others. By the way, I have talked about Qi Men Dun Jia in a prior video titled Tai Qi and its 8 Gate Forces. Link is in the description. Since this video focuses on Jiu Gong in the context of the internal arts, which include Xiu Dao, I'd like to briefly introduce the application of Jiu Gong in Xiu Dao practice. In Xiu Dao practice, Daoist practitioners apply the Jiu Gong and Ba Gua concepts to indicate the specific methods to manage the energy refinement process. More specifically, practitioners apply different levels of Feng and Huo, or Wind and Fire, to manage the levels of mental activities in the energy refining process. Feng Huo is related to inner energy changes and external environmental conditions, such as the state of the moon, which is emphasized in Xiu Dao since it has a very close relationship with the inner energy level. And all of those factors and elements can be expressed and conceptualized by using Jiu Gong and Ba Gua or 9 palaces and 8 trigrams. This is the Xiu Dao related topic, and I will explain it in more detail in a future Xiu Dao video. Also, in Taoism, people use Jiu Gong to indicate the 9 locations of the brain, which is said to have different functions in Xiu Dao practice. For example, Huang Tingjing said, quote, Shang Yuan Wei Jiu Gong, Zhong Yu Jiu Zhen Shen, Ge Ju Yi Dong Fang, Gu Nao Yu Jiu Gong. The upper Dantian has nine palaces, and each real spirits are inside of it. Each spirit has a space, so that there are nine palaces in the brain. In another important Taoist document, Da Dong Jing, which was developed based on Huang Ting Jing, even provided a specific name for each palace. They are Ming Tang Gong, Tian Ting Gong, Ji Zhen Gong, Dan Xuan Gong, Tai Huang Gong, Yu Di Gong, Liu Zhu Gong, Ni Wan Gong, and Dong Fang Gong. In practice, practitioners visualize different imagery in different palaces, which used to be a popular practice for about 1,000 years before Zhang Boduan's time, which was the milestone in Xiu Dao development, indicating the drastic alteration in nature to a pure internal energetic practice. Another Taoist energy practice called Yu Bu, or Stepping of Yu, named after the legendary figure Da Yu, said to have lived about 4,000 years ago, is used by Taoist priests in religious rituals in order to call on spirits, gain the energy, and cast away evil, and so on. It can also be used for physical exercise and qigong. The stepping pattern follows the Jiu Gong pattern. I did learn it from a Taoist friend when I was in my 20s, but I have not actively practiced it. This is the stepping pattern of Yu Bu. So, Yu Bu is an application of the Jiu Gong concept as well. We can see that throughout Chinese history, besides the popular practices which have applied Jiu Gong, such as Feng Shui, Qi Men Dun Jia, TCM, and many others, Jiu Gong has been used in Xiu Dao practice as well due to its dynamic nature. Also, in the early stage of Xiu Dao practice, Jiu Gong was also used to indicate some static concepts such as the nine area in the brain. Again, it is worth noting that the most popular application of Jiu Gong is the Qi Men Dun Jia, a very profound ancient practice in China and even today. It is still very popular in forecasting. I know some people in China are experts of this art. Personally, I perceive it as the statistical practice combined with psychology and other techniques developed to analyze different potential outcomes of an event. I studied it when I was a teenager without much success. Therefore, I'm not qualified to talk about Qi Men Dun Jia. So, let's look at Jiu Gong in the context of martial art. Topic 3. Jiu Gong in martial art. In martial art practice, traditionally, Jiu Gong is applied in two categories. First, a naming convention, and two, conceptual application in specific physical movements. Now, let me explain each of them. First, Jiu Gong as a naming convention. You may have already heard of some martial art routines called Jiu Gong, but actually, the Jiu Gong used in the names of those routines only indicates that those practices evolved using Jiu Gong to represent different directions and areas. For example, Chang Naizhou, the author of Chang Shi Wu Ji Shu, mentioned Jiu Gong in his book Chang Shi Wu Ji Shu. However, he only used it to describe the nine hand techniques based on nine directions of movements. Please check out my video titled Internal Style Concepts 30, Zhuan Guan, in which I have briefly introduced Chang Naizhou and his contribution to Chinese martial arts. While it's not explicitly mentioned in his book, in the case of stepping patterns, we can consider Jiu Gong to be a plate in the horizontal plane, Well, in the case of hand movements, we can consider 九宫to be a plate in the vertical plane. In other words, to describe the hand movements by using the 九宫 method, the plate is vertically in front of the practitioner. So, the eight directions of hand movement are expressed by eight outer palates of the 九宫, while the center palate is used to describe the forward and the backward movement of the hand, which is vertical to the plate. Again, I have to tell you that there are many routines recently using the term 九宫. Actually, it is just a naming method. There is no specific 九宫 practice in those routines. Even if anyone were to claim otherwise, it would at max be very primitive. So be careful, do not get fooled by a name. By the way, some new styles and routines have been created in the last two or three decades that use the term 九宫 in their practice. Since there are some specific physical practices utilizing the 九宫 concept, you could say those practices can use the name 九宫. However, an often occurring issue is that practitioners of those styles provide inflated claims about the history of their styles without any evidence, which is fraud. Since this video mainly focuses on the traditional styles, those invented practices are beyond the scope of today's video. 2. Now, let's talk about the second category, which is the conceptual application of 九宫 in specific movements. As I mentioned second ago, I will limit discussion to the traditional internal styles of martial arts. I have to say traditionally, only Ba Gua has specific practices fit to be included in this category, which involves not only the term as the naming method, but also includes a specific set of practices utilizing the concept. Hebei style Xing Yi has the practice as well, which I will talk about later. First, let's talk about Ba Gua. If we look at Ba Gua as a martial art style, the main objective is combat skill. So, Ba Gua, the martial art, is different from Yu Bu, the latter originally being a religious ritual which could also be used as an energy cultivation practice for health. But even though Yu Bu contains movements and specific stepping patterns, it was not created for martial art practice. That's why Yu Bu should never be considered martial 九宫. Regarding Ba Gua Zhang, I can say that most styles of Ba Gua contains 九宫 practice. Of course, the body method and the stepping pattern may differ, but the objective is the same, combat skill. So, Ba Gua, as I explained already, is the only style that has a specific 九宫 practice in this category. So, how about Xing Yi? Well, Xing Yi's 九宫 practice was borrowed from Ba Gua practice. When I was a teenager, I practiced simple 九宫 exercises that could be practiced alone or as two-person forms. The 九宫 practice of Xing Yi was developed by Zhang Zhaodong and Li Chunyi, since both of them practiced Ba Gua under Dong Haichuan. Years ago, I taught some of my students part of this routine in Montreal. Regarding schools in China today, well, I do not know any other school that practice this routine anymore. I will demonstrate part of it in the demonstration section. To summarize, as a well-informed practitioner, you have to be able to distinguish a traditional 九宫 practice both as the naming convention and as the conceptual application. So, how should you practice martial jiugong? That brings us to the next section. Topic 4, how to practice martial jiugong. I will use the jiugong practice in Chengxiao Bagua to explain actual practice. While I studied Bagua in China, my teacher Fu Shoubo taught me in a park which had an area with a lot of small trees. In northern China, a lot of aspen trees were planted in many places. They can grow very tall but are not that thick. So, the aspen tree trunk is flexible, making it suitable for practicing palm techniques. I practiced jiugong in parks with aspen trees. In the early stages of practice, I used the fixed stepping pattern of jiugong. After mastering the walking pattern, I focused on the body method as well as speed training. Eventually, you should focus on shenfa or body method instead of stepping patterns in your practice. And with time, the stepping pattern should become more flexible. In other words, you do not have to follow the fixed jiugong pattern, but instead, you should focus on the body method. For example, instead of just walking through the space between the trees, you can walk in circles around one tree, then move on to the next one. In the early stages, the distance between trees can be large. Then, with time, you can reduce the distance. If finding such a suitable spot provides difficult, you can use the grounded poles to practice. Finally, you do not have to practice it in between trees or poles. You can practice jiugong without trees. Practicing without trees is eventually a better approach but has to be practiced after mastering the practice with trees. By the way, I have practiced jiugong without a tree for years and I still like it. To summarize, start to practice jiugong in the woods with the considerably larger distance between two trees. Focus on the stepping pattern. Once you have mastered it, gradually shorten the distance between the trees and focus on the body method. Next, add more circle walkings around each tree before moving to the next stepping pattern. Later, increasing your speed, lower your body posture and add different type of body method practice. Eventually, practice without trees. That was a rather simplified procedure for Bagua Jiugong practice. I will find a suitable area in Montreal and make a video of Jiugong practice in the future. But I hope the procedure I just mentioned suffice to get you started in your Jiugong practice. On to the next topic. Topic 5. Misperceptions of martial Jiugong. Even though jiugong practice is not that popular nowadays, regardless, I have encountered quite a few misperceptions about it. I'd like to list a couple of them and correct them in today's video. First, as long as I follow the jiugong stepping pattern, I'm practicing martial jiugong. In martial art, the key objective of jiugong practice at an advanced level is to practice shenfa or body method. Stepping pattern is only a fundamental objective of jiugong. Also, while you should follow the fixed jiugong pattern in the early stages of your practice, you should gradually progress to a free stepping pattern. That is the correct way to practice jiugong. Of course, you can follow the jiugong stepping pattern and walk slowly for health benefits, but that is not the main objective of martial jiugong practice. So, you should be clear about your objective and accordingly choose the right approach. Second, 九宫 practice is for applying martial practice in fighting against multiple opponents at the same time. Well, another misconception. This is not true either. Practicing九宫 stepping is not for having the ability to fight against multiple opponents. 九宫 stepping is still intended for 身法 practice. It is a common misperception to think about the 八卦 circle walking as something meant for fighting against multiple opponents. Yes, any martial art practice at an advanced level will enable you to defeat multiple opponents whose practice is at a lower level. Changing direction and stepping fast.Is not designed for that at all. So, I recommend you focus on 身法 practice in 九宫 walking, instead of speculating about 九宫 applicability toward fighting against multiple opponents. I hope the correction of these two misperceptions will help you choose the right approach in practice. Again,Martial 九宫 practice is for combat skill and self-defense, neither for religious purposes nor is the 九宫 pattern meant to be always followed in a fixed manner. Topic 6, demonstration. Today, I'd like to introduce a 九宫 practice that is based on two-person exercise, but I will show it as a solo practice.The objective of this movement is to practice fast stepping so that you can walk to the back of your opponent, which is a part of a 八卦 self-defense strategy. This is a simple two-person exercise in 八卦 to practice the 九宫 stepping. So imagine here's a person. I just demonstrate the movement first.Okay, that's the first movement. So what you can do is like 1, 2, 3, then 1, 2, 3, then 2. Topic 7, takeaways. First, origin and history of 九宫. 九宫 has a very long history, which evolved from 洛书.An ancient mysterious number pattern which has been used in many fields including Chinese astrology, forecasting, and others. Second, 九宫 in different practices. As a theoretical foundation of many practices, 九宫 is widely applied in 奇门遁甲, Taoist art, and others. 3.九宫 in martial arts. 九宫八卦 stepping method is the martial practice used in 八卦 for improving body method purpose. 4. How to practice martial 九宫? Start by following the 九宫 pattern, then focus on the body method and eventually practice it without using any devices such as trees in a dynamic andflexible manner. 5. Misperceptions of martial 九宫. First, as long as I follow the 九宫 stepping pattern, I'm practicing martial 九宫. Second, 九宫 practice is for applying martial practice in fighting against multiple opponents at the same time. Do not forget to watch the demonstration and emulate the movements. Then practice it yourself.That brings us to the end of today's video. Thank you for watching. See you next time and enjoy your practice.